Thank you for organizing of this meeting. My topic is new approaches for developing viral vaccine against the influenza and respiratory syncytial virus. Influenza in historical in 1918, the Spanish flu is in human history the worst case, killing over 40 million people worldwide, most in the young, healthy people. In annual epidemic, most the people is affected is in all ages of the populations and young children and particularly young children and elderly, and also the hospitalization is over 10 to 20% in particularly in the young children and elderly, and most mortality happen in elderly in annual epidemic. In U.S. is estimate about over 40,000 people die because of the flu, the epidemic. In influenza is a negative strain RNA, a segmented strain RNA virus, and because of that is highly mutatable. So in 1918 is H1N1, which is a H1 type of hemagglutinin and the N1 type of neuraminidase on the surface of virus. Circulated over 40 years. Then 1957 the new strain introduced to humans is H2N2. Then 10 years later, so another pandemic, which is H3N2, which is a H3 type of hemagglutinin on the surface of influenza, and the N2 neuraminidase on the surface of the influenza. That's what we call the H3N2, and that is became another pandemic. Lots of people died. Then that two H1N1 and H3N2 are two different viruses continue circulating in human populations. Then in the middle of the 1970s is the swine flu is spread around the humans, but it's not continue circulating. Then in 1997 is avian flu in East Asian countries. Affected from poultry to the human, which is H5N1. This is highly pathogenic. Is from 18 confirmed cases, 6 died, is over 50% mortality. Then the avian H5N1 reoccurring in 2003. And then from there is annually is spreading outbreak to humans, and then it's a very high mortality. But until now, it's no the high transmissions among the humans, so it's not becoming a pandemic, even though very high concerns. And from 2000, people are expecting next pandemic might be from the mutation from highly pathogenic H5N1, but unexpectedly, 2009, the new antigens derived from the swine. It's a 2009 H1N1 swine-derived flu became a pandemic, and almost 20,000 people died in worldwide only this single the pandemic. And then it's 2013 in China, another virus from called the H7N9, killing over 100 people. And so this is flu is still highly problematic in humans. And I thought these are two major challenges in here. So one is the still is a concern. Current human influenza is H1N1 and H3N2, and the two types of the flu V, but it's not yet this avian influenza. Also, it's not for the not prepared for pandemic. And current vaccine is a highly strain specific based on the immunity to the hemagglutinin. So if it's a new strain introduced to humans, it's a current vaccine would not be effective. So those two are the major concern. Also, is the other type of the more effective the vaccination and delivery and manufacturing and many other things. But I'm focusing on these two. So current flu vaccines are mainly produced from the individual egg, the fertilized egg. So this is highly time-consuming and very labor-intensive, and it takes usually about 6 months for preparing the vaccine in the beginning of the winter terms. So our approach is how about whether we can make the subunit vaccines based on the virus-like particles. This is in morphology structure similar to virus, but it's not containing the viral genomes. So this is a non-infectious virus particles, and we initially developed based on the HIV, then we applied this concept to the influenza. So the way of the vaccine production, so we identify what is a protective antigen from the pathogens. Then we generate the recombinant bacterial virus expressing these proteins. Then we co-infection in the insect cells expressing the core protein of structure, which is a main driving force in self-assembly, then budding into virus-like particle forms. Then we also co-express the membrane surface, the glycoprotein. So during the particle buddings, these particles encapsulate, they incorporate this glycoprotein on the surface. And even though these particles are produced in the insect cells called supernatant, the morphologies under the EM are very similar to the replicating virus in mammalian cells. Then we confirm the incorporation of the glycoproteins, hemagglutinin, by Western and ELISA. So we have done most of this study in preclinical the animal models, more focusing on the avian H5N1 or 2009 H1N1. This is the result. Is the in animal models, it is highly highly immunogenic, and it more likely induce the IgG2A type and the which is Th1. And compared to the different from the split or subunit, which is more likely Th2, which is IgG1 type, and not effective in T cell, but it can induce the CD4 and CD8 T cell response. And also, it's quite long lasting, even single immunization, it can induce protective immunity. By the way, in the company, it's a very successful biotech company in less than 20 or 25 years called the Novavax. Novavax is very, very successful in testing this subunit, the VLP vaccine in humans. So in cases, they testing the trivalent, the seasonal vaccine. Current vaccine is put in the egg, so they produce in the VLP in insect cell system, and they test in the humans. And another is 2009 actually in a pandemic, also they test in human in clinical phase 2. Then they follow up with avian H5N1 VLP vaccine in testing the in phase 1 and 2 in human clinical studies. Then is the same year, amazingly, is an outbreak in avian H7N9 in March, April. They generated the VF vaccine within a month. Then they tested in the human and also animal models in the same year. And this is a very fast in response to the influenza outbreak they produced, and then they test in the humans. This is a very amazing advancement done by the company is Novavax. So, which that means is these approaches seem to be quite viable for the developing the new vaccine for the human influenza. So the problem is in 2009, I mean 2008, there's no the issue in providing, supplying the human, the flu vaccine and vaccination. And also the flu, the epidemic is usually happen in the winter seasons. But it's unusually the non-identifiable flu symptoms happen in California and the Mexico in early March and late April in 2009. Then is that flu symptom is because it's a new antigen introduced is not easily diagnostic which type of the flu. Then later from the gene sequencing and identification, they found that this is the swine-derived new flu, and it became very highly transmissible through the air among the human population, and it became the pandemic in within a few months, spreading whole the worldwide. And this first and second wave in summer, and then all school closed. Then it's a little bit down. Then it's when school start this third wave in September or so the vaccines available in after the downside of the third wave. So what does it mean? Current flu manufacturing and vaccination cannot meet the need flu pandemic if it happens. And that the mortality is not very high. It's very similar to the seasonal. So it's, that's why it can be controlled. But it's, if its mortality is high, it's like the avian, then this is it's really tragic. So when we look at the why this is a human flu vaccine is only for the strain specific, because the current the immunity is based on the hemagglutinin, which is a very highly variable antigenic target. So when we look at the flu genes, there's a called the M2 ion channel protein on the surface of the flu, and which is called M2. M2 is a 23 amino acid, very small protein, but it's unusually is very highly conserved. It's over 99.9% conserved in H1N1, H3N2, the human flu. So using the VLP technology, we can dissect different antigen in single antigen in particle form. So we can test contribution of the protection to the hemagglutinin and uraminidase and the M2, the highly conserved. So we took it M2 as a universal the flu vaccine, the target antigens. So, this is a wild type, this is a human. So we engineered, we are adding the main focus in humans, this M2, the active domain. Then we add a small couple of amino acids, different swine-derived flu, and the avian flu drive. So then, because the M2 is not highly incorporated into the virus, so we engineered, we changed the transmembrane domain and cytoplasmic domain with hemagglutinin, because hemagglutinin is the most dominant protein on the pathogens, over 500 trimer. But this M2 is less than 20-30 molecules. It's very not much protein. Also, its size is very small. So we make it big, and also it's engineering the incorporating the domain, then we could incorporate this M2 tandem repeat over several hundred higher than the real virus. Then we tested in mouse, and then this tandem repeat heterologous this M2 protein on the surface of particles when immunized in a mouse, then this mouse induce antibody to the human M2 and the avian M2 and swine M2. So in the protections, this is the current HA based vaccines. They induce good protection against the same strain, but it's a strange change. It does not provide the protection. So we can induce protection in different the hemagglutinin antigen containing H1N1, H3N2, and H5N1. But this, because M2 based the vaccines is not a neutralizing antibody. This is most in the Fc mediated the NK cell the mediated and the protection. So because of the non-neutralizing mediated protection, the efficacy is a little bit low compared to hemagglutinin based. So another alternative approach is just the strain-specific the hemagglutinin vaccine, then supplementing the providing the conserved epitope-based vaccine. So we call the supplemented vaccination, and it works quite very well in mouse. So for example, this red color is a current vaccine-based. I mean, this good protection, but once when you challenge a different strain, it does not provide good protection. But so when you're providing this one, we can make it straight. This is preventing the mortality and also is a morbidity. And this is we can provide in different H1N1, H3N2, and then H5N1s. Then we are now testing in the ferret animal model, which is a more relevant the preclinical animal model before the human trials. Another approach is one of the current flu is a live attenuated influenza virus, which is called the LARV. So we try to engineer because it's a hemagglutinin is a major antigenic target, and we modify the hemagglutinin incorporating the conserved antigenic target called the M2. So this M2 and HA, then we can generate the replicating the influenza. So this is a recombinant the influenza, and we are aiming to develop the highly improved the live attenuated flu vaccines. So this is the wild type, and then this is M2 HA chimeric. So it's HA is highly expressed on the surface of virus. Then we can incorporate this replicating form, this conserved target on the surface of the virus in a form of HA. Okay. Then we can test many different. Then this is red color is the current form of the live form of the flu. And this is the blue one is the quite significantly potential improved compared to the current flu vaccine platforms. And then we are now testing in the mouse, this concept we're planning for in ferret and also in the avian case in chicken models. So too late. So I just kick a couple of minutes in the concept in the RSV, and this is no vaccine. This RSV is mostly affecting the very young infant, and this is respiratory is still a significant problem in infectious disease, and also is this Novavax company they developed the insect cell derived the RSV F fusion protein is nanoparticles and they. Pass in the clinical 1 and 2, and they are aiming for the page 3. we developed this concept in the VLPs, and then we test in mouse. And one of the problem in RSV in early 1960s, they are testing the formalin inactive the RSV in young children, and then they following next the winter season, the vaccinated children develop the disease we call the vaccine enhanced disease. So this is very different from influenza, and the vaccine enhanced disease is one of the major challenging difficulty in developing the RSV with the vaccine. So we focus on whether this vaccine is induced the vaccine enhanced the lung inflammation. This is the FI's formalin inactivated the whole virus RSV in human and also in the animal model. They are, even though they are, can clear the lung viral, but they still the host derived the immune enhanced. The vaccinated group is more disease, inflammation than unvaccinated. But is our approach is can be viable. This is the mucus production in the fast staining, and then this is we are testing the cotton models. And the summary is we can apply this concept in the flu and the RSV, and this is the. Support from the most in the NIH, the funding, and thank you for your questions.